Matthew chapter 7. We're going to be looking this morning at verses 15 through 20. Matthew chapter 7, verses 15 through 20. Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves. You will know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Even so, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a bad tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Therefore, by their fruits you will know them. Now, the Lord has been speaking to people who have gathered together in what is called traditionally the Sermon on the Mount. And as you know, we've been going through the Gospel of Matthew. We arrived at the Sermon on the Mount, which begins in chapter 5. And we've been looking at this message that the Lord Jesus Christ has been giving there in this particular location in the north portion of Israel by the Sea of Galilee. And as the Lord has been ministering there, we saw how that he had given an invitation. He had first stated in verse 24 of chapter 6 that no one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. And Jesus had stated, you cannot serve God and mammon. And so as he had done that, he is now beginning to set the stage for his invitation. And I mentioned that to you last time. When preaching of the gospel is present, there is an invitation, and that's what Jesus Christ was doing. He was giving an invitation, and that's why last time we were together, we saw that he gave that invitation in chapter 7, verse 13, when he said, enter by the narrow gate. And so that was his invitation. Now, it's interesting that Jesus is giving an invitation to enter in, and then, notice with me, then he gives a warning. First, he gives an invitation as a true prophet, Jesus being a true prophet, but then he gives a warning concerning false prophets. Now, why is that? It's because when the Lord gives his word and somebody begins to respond to it, immediately the enemy, like in a cosmic chess match, will attempt to make a move to undermine the work that God intends to do. Jesus speaks later on concerning how a sower goes out to seed, he sows some seed, it goes to the wayside. Birds come and immediately take that seed before it has an opportunity to germinate. The enemy has a way of trying to steal the seed so it doesn't produce the crop that God would have, the harvest that God would have in those who would receive what the Word of God has to say. The enemy has a way of bringing people into your lives, especially when you were first saved, to try and undermine the work that God began through your listening to and reception of the Word of God. When I first got saved, I was 20 years old. I went, heard the gospel, gave my heart to Christ. They told me, begin to read the Bible. I'm brand new in the Lord. I'm a brand new Christian, 20 years old. And I was reading the Bible and all and starting to grow. When on one occasion, probably within no longer than three weeks or so after me committing my heart to Christ, there's a knock on the door at my parents' house where I was living at the time. I remember going and opening the door, and I kind of startled the people who were standing there because I was a hippie, so I had longer hair. I was wearing a Japanese silk robe with a big dragon in the back. I was barefooted. I mean, that's how I went out like that. That's formal wear. That was formal wear. That's when you wanted to impress people. And so I answered the door. That's just the way that I dressed. And as I opened the door, there are these two women standing at the door, and they're looking at me, and I'm smiling back at them. How can I help you? I say to them, well, we are representatives, we are Christians, representatives of the kingdom of God, and we wanted to share with you a little bit about God and the Bible. And I said, oh, that's great. That's wonderful. I said, I just gave my heart to Jesus Christ just recently, and I want to talk about him. And they said, oh? And then they said, well, we are Jehovah's Christian witnesses. Now, you call yourself Christians and this and that. Let's talk about Jesus. And I still remember them conversing with me and sharing with me, and I'm a brand new believer. And at a certain point, I said to them something like, you know, what you're saying, I don't think I agree with. I said, I don't think I agree with it. I said, but that's cool. I didn't know what to say. Well, later on, I discovered that these people were members of a cult, and they were sharing things that were just not scripturally solid, right? And so the enemy has a way of moving immediately to undermine the work that God wants to do. I'm certain that there are people in this room who came to faith in Christ who, within just a short time, before you know it, you had people sharing with you their faith and the things you ought to do in order to really know God, the book you ought to read, or the place you ought to attend, or whatever. They come out of the woodworks, because Jesus makes it clear that false prophets are evangelists. They come to you, is what he says. And that's a fact. Indeed, they do. They come out of the woodwork. They don't just stand in front of Winchell's and talk to people. They will come to you, and they will speak to you, and they try to draw you away. And so Jesus is making it very clear here that these false prophets are evangelistic. They come to you. Now, notice with me that he warns them of false prophets and is instructing them so that they have what is called discernment, the ability to judge properly, discernment. And he wants them to have this discernment. You see, because if God has a true prophet, Satan will attempt to undermine God through a false prophet. And so we need to know the difference between light and darkness. And so that's what he would have us to do. You see, fake prophets will present themselves as genuine, and the unsuspecting, unequipped can be deceived. Paul, when he was writing to the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians in chapter 11, verses 13 through 15, speaking of them, said it like this. He said, "These people are false apostles. They have fooled you by disguising themselves as apostles of Christ. But I'm not surprised. Even Satan can disguise himself as an angel of light. So it is no wonder his servants can also do it by pretending to be godly ministers. In the end, they will get every bit of punishment their wicked deeds deserve. So they're Jehovah's Christian witnesses, or they're Church of God, Latter-day Saints, Church of Jesus Christ, Latter-day Saints. That they will give you the impression that they know the Lord. They even use Jesus' name in the title of their cult. But in reality, they're false prophets." Now, when you read your Bible, you discover that false prophets, false teachers, were not something new in the history of Israel. Israel had a relationship with the true God. And because Israel did, Satan moved to undermine their relationship with him. And that's because Satan's greatest desire is to keep people away from God and to keep them in spiritual bondage. In the Old Testament, false religions arose, and the false prophets wielded tremendous influence. They intended to influence people to worship the gods that the false prophets presented to Israel. So God calls them out. He tells his people that these false prophets are misleading them. They're drawing them away. In Jeremiah 23, verse 32, an Old Testament book with an Old Testament prophet whom God inspired to write these words. In Jeremiah 23:32, the Lord says, "Behold, I am against those who prophesy false dreams, says the Lord, and tell them and cause my people to err by their lies and by their recklessness. Yet I didn't send them or command them. Therefore, they shall not profit this people at all, says the Lord. They tell lies. They lead my people to err. I didn't send them. I'm not inspiring them. They're not going to profit you at all." You see, all the way when God began to speak to Moses and was giving him what is called the law, God gave instructions to Moses concerning those who would try to seduce Israel. In the Old Testament book of Deuteronomy, the fifth book of the Old Testament, in Deuteronomy chapter 13, verses 1 through 4, God said, "If there arises among you a prophet or a dreamer of dreams, and he gives you a sign or a wonder, and the sign or the wonder comes to pass of which he spoke to you, saying, 'Let us go after other gods, which you have not known, let us serve them,' You shall not listen to the words of that prophet or that dreamer of dreams. For the Lord your God is testing you to know whether you love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul. You shall walk after the Lord your God and fear him and keep his commandments and obey his voice, and you shall serve him and hold fast to him. And so God says there will be false people who will arise. They'll even have dreams, visions, prophetic utterances. He said, this is all giving you an opportunity to demonstrate the reality of your faith. If they say to you, follow after a God that you have not known, even if what they're saying has come true, even if it appears to be coming true even, do not follow after them. Israel had been warned, but Israel developed a habit of listening to false prophets. You know, the message of the false prophet normally is extremely appealing. The false prophets very often will say things that people want to hear. They're saying things that people would like to hear. Isaiah chapter 30, verses 9 and 10, the Lord says, this is a rebellious people, lying children, children who will not hear the law of the Lord, who say to the seers, do not see, to the prophets, do not prophesy to us right things. Speak to us smooth things. Prophesy deceits. We prefer what you're saying over what the Bible actually teaches. Say something to me that's smooth. Say something that makes me feel good about myself. Say something I already agree with. In Jeremiah 5, 30 and 31, it says, a horrible and shocking thing has happened in the land. The prophets prophesy lies. The priests rule by their own authority. And my people love it that way. Often false prophets and false teachers will appeal to what the people are inclined to believe already. In the New Testament, false prophets and false teachers seek to turn us away from Jesus Christ. And the basic message of the false teacher is that Jesus is really not that important. Now, they'll refer to him in certain ways, but they always reduce him. They'll say things like, well, he's a good man, or he's a great teacher. Sometimes they'll even say, Jesus Christ, of course, he's a prophet. They always will say glowing things about him. They don't necessarily attack him, not directly most of the time. They just add things and reduce him. When I was in the Army, I met a guy who was a Christian Scientist. And so I thought a Christian Scientist was a guy who studied science. I didn't know that it was a religion. So he said, oh, I'm a Christian Scientist. I said, really? I said, well, you know, that's interesting. So you like science? And he says, no. He says, that's not what a Christian Scientist is. And I discovered later on that a Christian Scientist teaches that Jesus embodied what is called the divinity of God, but that Jesus Christ himself was not God. They always reduce Jesus. Mormons will teach that Jesus and Satan are spirit brothers and sons of God. Jehovah's Witnesses will say that Jesus is Michael the Archangel, and they say he is the first creation of God. Or you speak to somebody who's a member of Islam. Islam rejects Jesus as God in the flesh. They do not believe he is the Son of God. They reject his crucifixion, his resurrection, and they reject his atonement. Now, obviously, that's not what the Bible says concerning the Lord Jesus Christ. Billy Graham once wrote, Buddha never claimed to be God. Moses never claimed to be Jehovah. Muhammad never claimed to be Allah. Yet Jesus Christ claimed to be the true and living God. Buddha simply said, I am a teacher in search of the truth. Jesus said, I am the truth. Confucius said, I never claimed to be holy. Jesus said, which of you convicts me of sin? Muhammad said, unless God throws his cloak over me, I have no hope. Jesus said, unless you believe in me, you will die in your sins. They will always reduce Christ, but the Bible always shows us who he truly is. When you study your scriptures, early in the history of the church, there were false teachers who began to arise, and they would reduce Jesus Christ. And because that was happening, Paul wrote several letters, and some of the letters that he wrote were specifically dealing with the things that were creeping in. One of the letters that he wrote was to the church of Colossae. And in Colossians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, he said this. He said, "Don't let anyone lead you astray with empty philosophy and high-sounding nonsense that comes from human thinking and from the evil powers of this world and not from Christ. For in Christ, the fullness of God lives in a human body." Jesus Christ is God in the flesh. And so false teachers may say glowing things about him. Oh, he's a good man. He is a prophet. He's a great teacher. But good men who are prophetic teachers do not lie. The fact that Jesus is not, if Jesus were not what he says he is, then he wouldn't be speaking the truth. And if he's not speaking the truth, why would I follow someone like that? Jesus Christ is God in the flesh. And the Word of God makes it very clear. And so Jesus is now warning people concerning the false teachers and false prophets that they will encounter once they commit themselves to him. And so in verse 15, with that in mind, Jesus says that, "Beware of false prophets," notice, "who come to you in sheep's clothing." Now, false prophets have the appearance of being genuine. During the time of Christ and in the Old Testament, those who were prophetic or prophets often were identifiable by the way that they dressed. They sometimes wore what would be called uncomfortable and very plain clothing. If you look in, for example, the Old Testament book of Zechariah 13, verse 4, it says, "On that day, every prophet will be ashamed of his prophetic vision. He will not put on a prophet's garment of hair in order to deceive." A prophet's garment of hair. They were identifiable by the way they dressed. Speaking of the prophet Elijah in 2 Kings 1, verse 8, that verse tells us that the prophet Elijah wore a garment of hair. In the New Testament, you had John the Baptist. He wore clothing that identified him as a prophet. Matthew chapter 2, verse 4 says, "John himself was clothed in camel's hair." Now, when Jesus was pointing out that John was true, he mentioned the way he dressed. In Matthew 11, verse 8, "What did you go out to see? A man clothed in soft garments?" You see, prophets would wear clothing that identified them as prophets. Also, shepherds wore garments that were made of wool. So he's saying false prophets appear to be the real thing. They don't necessarily deceive the people by impersonating sheep alone. They deceive them by not only impersonating sheep, but also by impersonating shepherds. They have the appearance of a shepherd. They will carry the huge family Bible. They'll have the huge fish around their neck. They have the appearance, and people will think they're the real thing. They impersonate. Not only do they impersonate sheep, but they also impersonate shepherds. When a shepherd is amongst the sheep, it's interesting. I didn't know this. I was just recently, this was taught to me, and I thought, how interesting. So I'll share it with you, because I thought it was interesting as they brought it forth. When a shepherd is amongst the sheep, The shepherd, because he's amongst the sheep, actually picks up the smell of a sheep. Now, I've never been a shepherd in that capacity, but that's true. I mean, they're amongst the sheep, and they're there with them quite often, and as they're amongst the sheep will rub against them. Sometimes they pick up the sheep and carry them, and they're spending a lot of time with them, and they actually pick up the smell of the sheep. And a false teacher can actually have that kind of, we'll say, sheep odor about him. He seems like he's the real thing, in other words. He smells like the real thing. They dress like a real minister in the sense of they have that outer appearance, and people will look at them and say, well, this person indeed knows the Lord. He carries a Bible. He's got a nixthus. He has bumper stickers. He goes to a particular church. They can appear Christian. They'll speak concerning Jesus Christ. They'll speak concerning the Bible. They'll talk about salvation. They talk about the Spirit. They speak about love. But they're deceivers. And Jesus says they're dangerous and destructive as ravenous wolves. False prophets appear genuine, but in reality, they are destructive. Again, some of the things that they say make sense to the innocent person that they're speaking to. And they will come to you to deceive. So you need to know the truth so you can identify them. When our church first began, I had a small office, about 80 square feet, in a small office complex on B Street and in Ontario. And I can remember it was a holiday, something like maybe it was the Thanksgiving or something, I forget what day, but it was a holiday, and I had a key to get into this small complex. I had a small office on the left side, so you would step in, and the first office to the left was my office. There were three offices on that left side, an aisleway, and then three offices on the right side. And I went in there while Marie was doing some preparation for Thanksgiving, I believe it was. And I went in there to do some work. And as I was there, I was the only person in the office complex. And I can remember hearing the door open that led into the aisleway. And then directly across from me, I heard somebody trying to open the door. And I knew that I was the only person in that complex and that eventually that person was going to come to my door. I knew that, so I was kind of seated there. My desk was facing my door, so I'm waiting for the door, someone to knock on the door. It was interesting because I heard him go to every door, and then he came on my side where I was, and then I hear a knock on the door, and I said, "Who's there?" And the door swings open, but only about 5 or 6 inches. It was kind of odd. And so as the door swung open, I see a hand that comes in, just a hand comes into the room. And I'm looking at this hand, and it's got little finger puppets. It is like little teeny hats on his fingers with eyes and nose and smiles. And the hand comes in. And I said, "Can I give you a hand?" No, I said, "How can I help you?" And then one of the fingers starts talking to me. And he's talking with a high voice. "Hi, what are you doing?" You know, and I'm just kind of hanging out, you know. I'm like, before you know it, that's where that saying, talk to the hand, came from, I guess. I know, but I start talking to the hand. And as he's talking to me, I finally said, "Hand, why don't you bring the rest of your body in?" And so the guy comes into the room, and he says, "Hi, I'm from the Holy Spirit Association, and I'm going through the area asking for donations for the work that we're doing in our ministry." And I said, "Oh, so you're in a ministry?" And he goes, "Yes, the Holy Spirit Association." And I said, "Listen, I'm familiar with the churches in this area, and I've never heard of that particular title, Holy Spirit Association. Who are you associated with, and where do you come from? You're not from this area." He goes, "Oh, I'm from Los Angeles." He said, "They just bring us in, and then we just go to door, and we solicit funds for our ministries." And so I began to speak to him, and before you know it, I find out he's from what was called the Moonies. He was a Moonie. And so he was a member of a cult. And so they will go out, and they will go through office complexes and the whole nine yards to try to bring you to believe whatever it is, what brand of religion they're selling. For them, the Unification Church believed that Sun Myung Moon, whom they called Reverend Sun Myung Moon, they believed that he actually completed the work that Jesus failed to do. They believe that Jesus failed to actually marry a woman who could produce perfect children, and Sun Myung Moon had done that, and that was part of their theology at that time. And there he is speaking to me, trying to share with me. So they come out, and they'll speak about Christ. They'll say good things about him. Oh, he's a good man. He's a prophet. He's a teacher. But they change him. They always reduce him to something less than what he really is. And so Jesus is speaking concerning that, and he's speaking about these imposters. You see, the bottom line is, they will look you right in the eyes. They will say things that they believe, but they are totally wrong. Not only do they deceive themselves, but they go out of the way to bring deceit to other people. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 13 and verse 14, Paul said, "Evil people and imposters will flourish. They will go on deceiving others, and they themselves will be deceived." But you must remain faithful to the things you have been taught. You know they are true, for you know you can trust those who taught you. Now, why would Jesus refer to them as ravenous wolves? Again, remember, in Israel, wolves were the most common enemy of sheep and were deadly to them. They look like, they talk like, and in every way appear to be a true prophet. And since they do, how will you know them? Well, Jesus in verse 16 says, you will know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? You see, the one who is speaking for God is to be judged by his life as well as his words. His life should adorn the gospel. His words should never contradict its message. Fruit trees can be beautiful when used for landscaping. If you go, there are some places they sell a particular orange. I've tasted this particular fruit of this particular orange tree. It's really an ornamental tree, because the fruit in and of itself, if you pick the fruit and you begin to try to eat it, it's a very bitter fruit. And they use this particular orange really for marmalade and things like that. But it's really not something that you can go to a tree and pick it and eat the fruit. So you have ornamental trees. But this is speaking about a fruit tree. And a fruit tree has a primary purpose. It's intended to produce fruit that is edible. And a false teacher and the true teacher is to be judged by the fruit that it produces. Not just how it looks, but the fruit that is produced. When Paul was speaking concerning the fruit of the Spirit, you see, the fruit of the Spirit really ought to be something that is so evident in the life of the teacher. If you want to be protected, you have to be careful not to just like the person speaking to you. They have a great personality. They're very winsome. They're the kind of person that you enjoy, and they make you laugh, and they do all of those things. But you have to be careful, because personality can deceive. You can wear a mask, and you can pretend to be a certain thing, or you may be very sincere at what you're deceived at yourself, and you're so deceived at what you believe, you can actually be a great salesman for deceit rather than truth. So you have to look for other things in them. And Jesus said you have to look for the fruit. So you look in Galatians chapter 5, and you see in verse 22 that Paul begins to speak there concerning fruit, and he speaks of the fruit of love. And as a result, if you really have the love of God, you have also peace, and you have long-suffering, you have kindness and goodness, you have faithfulness and gentleness, you have self-control. This is the fruit of the Spirit, and this is something that is evidence in the life of a true teacher. When John the Baptist was speaking about this life that had fruit, he warned in Matthew 3:8, he warned the people, and he said, bear fruit worthy of repentance. So a genuine teacher is going to have a repentant lifestyle. Not that he just repented that one time and got saved and never repents again. A believer's life, and for some of you this might be important to remember, a believer's life is a lifetime of repentance. It's a daily repentance. God, I have failed in thought, word, and deed. Forgive me, a sinner. If a man says, I have no sin, he's not speaking the truth. We all, every day, will fail in one way or another. It's a lifestyle of repentance. And a genuine teacher has a repentant humility. You see that in them. When Paul was writing in Romans chapter 6, verse 22, he said, having been set free from sin, having become slaves of God, you have your fruit to holiness and the end, everlasting life. A repentance, a holiness, the love of God, these are things that are evidenced in a true teacher. Any person speaking God's message evidences good fruit in their attitude as well as their action. You see, abiding in Christ produces evidence of salvation. Jesus said in John 15, 4 and 5, abide in me and I in you. As a branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. So every good tree, in verse 17, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. And so there's the fruit of their life. This is the nature and condition of the tree revealed. No matter how healthy the tree appears, if it's unhealthy, it can only produce bad fruit. Now, what are the fruits that can reveal them to be false? I want to give you a few things to contrast the fruit of a false teacher with that of the true. First thing you're going to see about a false teacher, number one, is a false teacher will add or subtract from the message of the gospel. They're going to tell you things like, you need to buy my book, you need my study guide in order to really know the truth. They're going to say things to you like, the Bible is not enough. That's what the Mormons will tell you. They'll say the Book of Mormon is a companion to the Bible. They'll say you need the Doctrines and Covenants. You need the Pearl of Great Price. Jehovah's Witnesses will give you the Watchtower publishing that they have. They'll give to you the variety of things that they have that is published from their headquarters and that all the Jehovah's Witnesses distribute. They will not have you study the Word of God by itself. Many years ago now, when I was in my early 20s and I had gotten out of the military, my mom had met somebody who was a Jehovah's Witness who had come to the door and had spoken to my mom. And my mom was a new Christian, as I. And my mom wanted me to meet this woman. And so I was going to school at that time. And I came home from class. The woman was at the house, and I remember meeting her. She was a Mexican woman, spoke fluent Spanish, because as we were speaking, she was speaking about Spanish. And I said, you know, I would really love to learn Spanish. And we were speaking to one another, and she says, oh, I can teach you that. I said, really? So she made herself very available to me. She said, but you know what I'd like to do? I'd like to teach you the Bible in Spanish. I'll teach you the Bible in Spanish. I said, really? And she said, but we're going to need to use the Jehovah's Witness literature that I have so we can do Bible studies together. And I said, why don't we just read the Gospel of John together? Why don't we just go through the Gospel of John, verse by verse, chapter by chapter, see what John has to say about Jesus? Oh, no, she tells me, I can't do that. And I said, why can't you? Because we're not allowed to read the Bible without our helps. See, the Jehovah's Witnesses believe that their publication has taken the place of the Holy Spirit. They believe that it's their teachings that are actually going to bring you into truth and enlightenment. The founder of the Jehovah's Witnesses said that if you just read the Bible without the Jehovah's Witnesses' helps, that in a year of just reading the Bible without their helps, you will go back into darkness. The point he was making is you'll be set free and walk into the light, because you've gotten away from their publications, because false prophets will always either add to or subtract from the gospel message. They often will offer to you what might be called a new revelation. They find it attractive, and it attracts an audience. But Paul said it like this in 2 Timothy 4, verses 3 and 4. He said, the time will come when men will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths. And that time is now. When you go into a Bible study, there are a lot of people who don't have a desire to really know what the Scripture says. They want to be entertained. And so they'll go places that will have the sound, the light, the smoke. They'll have all the excitement, the enthusiasm, the sweating preacher, and the whole nine yards. I really got a lot out of it today. Well, what did he teach on? I don't know, but man, I'm enthusiastic about Jesus. And that's kind of what happens. I mean, this big movement, you know, we got to have the greatest music. I love music, by the way. I love to worship the Lord in song, of course. But I've spoken to people whose whole, the church's whole emphasis is their bands and the kind of music that they have. And I've said to them, listen, you know, if somebody comes to your door and they don't know the Lord, what are you going to do? Bring your tambourine out and start singing to them, my God is an awesome God? I mean, how are you going to reach them for Christ? How's that going to happen if you don't know Scripture? If you don't know the Word of God, how's that going to happen? Well, we just bring them, and they get into the flow. Without the gospel, without the word, without the preaching of the cross, there's no way they can get saved without Jesus Christ's word. They need the word of God. Because you may not enjoy the music, but you better get into the word, because it's the word that sets you free. And Paul said the day's coming, and indeed we are in that day. The day is coming when they will no longer put up with healthy teaching. They will heap unto themselves teachers having itching ears. They will voluntarily turn aside from the truth and turn unto fables. Voluntarily is how that is reading. They will turn away so that they can be entertained. A genuine teacher does not change the message. They will teach the Bible to the best of their ability out of a love and a fear for God and a love for God's people. In Proverbs 30, verses 5 and 6, every word of God is pure. He is a shield to those who put their trust in Him. Do not add to his words, lest he rebuke you and you be found a liar. It's the truth that sets you free. And the minister, who is a true minister, knows he has been entrusted with the message. Paul spoke of that in this way in 1 Thessalonians 2, 3 and 4. He said, the appeal we make does not spring from error or impure motives, nor are we trying to trick you. On the contrary, we speak as men approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel. We are not trying to please men, but God who tests our hearts. We're not going to give you, he said, a message that tickles your ear to make you keep coming back because you like what you're getting. We will give you the whole counsel of God. A genuine teacher will not change the message. Truth is what sets you free. And that's why verse-by-verse teaching is the best method. A second thing, false prophets draw disciples after themselves. A false teacher is busy building an empire. They establish their own name recognition. They want the fame and admiration of men. Paul said it like this in Acts 20, verse 30, from your own number, men will arise and distort the truth in order to draw away disciples after themselves. We used to call it spiritual scalps. They want to have people following after them, their way of thinking. But a true minister will point people to Jesus Christ, and they do not seek to be known themselves. They want people to be like Jesus. That's why in John 3, verse 30, we read, he must increase, I must decrease. That's why Paul in Galatians 4:19 would say, my little children, of whom I travail in birth again until Christ is formed in you. A true minister points people to Jesus. Third, false prophets are greedy for money, and they use people for personal gain. In Titus chapter 1, verses 10 and 11, there are many rebellious people, mere talkers and deceivers, especially those of the circumcision group. They must be silenced, because they're ruining whole households by teaching things they ought not to teach, and that for the sake of dishonest gain. They like to make money off of you. Years ago, many years ago now, I was teaching a series. It's when we were in Ontario high schools, so it's been a number of years. I was doing a series, and I began to quote some of the better-known teachers at that time who were polluting the gospel with error. And I quoted a particular man. And when I quoted him, I didn't know this, but a member of his church was in church services that day. And so, some while later, I was teaching at the Calvary Chapel Bible College. It was in Twin Peaks at the time. And a guy walks up to me and says to me, Pastor, I want you to know I go to your church. And I said, oh, well, great. He says, I feel called by God to become a minister, a pastor. I said, great, great. I had never met him. And he introduced himself to me and all. And he said, let me tell you how I got here. I said, okay. He said, I went to your church, and you were giving a study, and you quoted this particular teacher. He goes, I went to his church. And when you quoted him, I got angry at you. He says, I live in Pomona, but I was driving to his church. And as I would drive to his church, you know, I was doing that for some time. He goes, and now you said something about my pastor, and it got me very angry. And so you gave the teaching and the citation, so I wrote it down. He says, I have all of his tapes at home. And I went, I found that tape that you quoted. It was called a cassette tape for the younger ones. They used to have something called cassettes. He said, I got the cassette tape, and I played it. And he said, I waited until it got to that point that you quoted, and you quoted it accurately. So he said, I'm going to come and I'm going to prove him wrong. He said, so I went the next week, and you did it again. You quoted him a second time, and it got me angry. I went home, and I pulled that tape out, and I played it again, and you cited it correctly. He did say what you said he said. He goes, I started coming to your fellowship so I could find you wrong as long as I could. He said, and I realized, he said, I'd been making a mistake in listening to this teaching. So he said, so I'm coming to this Bible college because I feel called by God. His name is Ron Arbaugh, and he's the pastor of Calvary Chapel, San Antonio, Texas. He went and planted a church years ago, and God is moving in that particular church. And it's because the truth will set you free. And this particular guy was teaching error, and the error needed to be exposed because there were people who were being drawn away by it, and their lives were being destroyed. So I didn't say these things about Frederick K.C. Price. Some of you are wondering who. I didn't say things about him because I didn't like the man. I was taking his teachings and saying, be careful for this, it's error. And it indeed it was, and the truth does set you free. You see, a lot of times people will preach messages not because it honors the Lord, but because it lines the pocket. Not that Frederick K.C. Price was doing that, by the way. I should very greatly say it. That's not what I'm saying. But I will say, and you know this, I'm not speaking to a group of people who don't know this, there are many ministers who have used the gospel to line their pockets. There's no doubt about that. I don't know any minister who needs $65 million for an airplane. I don't know any. 50 maybe, 65, no. But that's the bottom line. They do it for the sake of dishonest gain. Now, true shepherds receive voluntary support, but they do not take financial advantage of those who give. In Galatians 6, verse 6, Paul instructs the church, let him who is taught the word share in all good things with him who teaches. In 2 Corinthians 2:17, Paul said, we are not as so many peddling the word of God, but as of sincerity, but as from God we speak in the sight of God in Christ. In 2 Corinthians 12:14, I am ready to visit you for the third time, and I will not be a burden to you, because what I want is not your possessions, but you. After all, children should not have to save up for their parents, but parents for their children. I think that I have parents in this room that are kind of like this. And, you know, if you spoke to one of my kids, it's the truth. It's the truth. You know, I don't expect them to take care of me. God entrusted me to care for them. So if I take my children out for dinner, say we go to, you know, hamburger place, sells 12-cent hamburgers. I don't make them pay. My children find it difficult to give me anything because I'm their father. I'm just not the kind of man who says, you owe me. You buy me a meal. I spent enough money on you as you grew up. Buy me a sandwich. I don't do that with my kids. I never have and never will. I'm the hardest person in the family for you to give anything to because I feel it's my responsibility to give to you. Now, they try to give to me, and I appreciate it, but there were years when my kids would say, Daddy, what do you want for Christmas? And I would say the same thing. I'd say, you can't afford what I want. And what you're going to give me, I'm going to give you money to buy anyway, so buy me something cheap. But it's a fact, isn't it? I mean, the children are not supposed to save up for the parents. The parents are supposed to take care of the kids. And that's the attitude that a true shepherd should have. A fourth thing, a false prophet has no love for God or God's children. In John chapter 10, verses 12 and 13, Jesus said it like this: the hired hand is not the shepherd who owns the sheep. So when he sees a wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. The wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he's a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. They don't care. They don't care about the sheep at all. And so if something happens, they're not there for them. They don't care about them. But on the other hand, a true shepherd lays his life down for the sheep. In John 10, verse 11, Jesus said it like this. He said, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Every genuine shepherd has scars on his hands from the attacks of wolves. Every genuine shepherd, if you look closely at their wrists, if you look closely at their hands, have scars. All of us do. From the attacks. And the times that I, in ministry, and by the way, I don't say this to elevate myself. I could say it about so many of my friends. But I'd prefer getting the glory, not them. But as I speak, honestly with you, in my years of experience, in the years that I've ministered, I began to minister the Word of God in September of 1973, at the age of 23. I've been teaching the Word of God since 1973, and I can tell you that over the years, I have, and my friends have been attacked in ways that we didn't believe was even possible. Because though the sheep are not necessarily dangerous, they do bite, and they do nip, and they do tear, and they do harm. They do. And every shepherd has endured some of the painful times with the sheep, but every shepherd has gone to bat for them against wolves. And everyone that I know, and I can name men that you respect and love highly, starting with Pastor Chuck and just moving on down the line, everyone that I know has wounds on their arms from taking the attacks that wolves have given. All of us have. All of us have gotten in front of a sheep that is being hurt. All of us have. And we have put our bodies on the line for them. And many times, the sheep that was being injured has turned around to bite and to leave the shepherd. I have had that happen so many times. I don't say that with anger. I have pain over it because it's sad to see. But that's a fact. A true shepherd will lay his life down for the sheep. That's what shepherds do. And who is the truest shepherd? Jesus Christ. And he said, a hireling sees the wolf come and he flees. He said, I am the good shepherd. I lay my life down. You can tell the difference between a true shepherd and the false by what he does when danger comes. The false does not care. A fifth thing, false prophets have disciples who make the gospel look bad by their bad living. In 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, Peter says, there were also false prophets among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you. They will secretly introduce destructive heresies, even denying the sovereign Lord who bought them, bringing swift destruction on themselves. Many will follow their shameful ways and will bring the way of truth into disrepute. So they bring shame to the gospel. But true shepherds desire the sheep to be like Jesus. They want the gospel to be admired. And that's why Paul would say in 1 Corinthians 4, verse 2, it is required in stewards that one be found faithful. And sixth, false prophets change Jesus from the Son of God, the second person of the Trinity, and the Savior. John said in 1 John 4, verses 1 through 3, beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits, whether they are of God. Because many false prophets have gone out into the world. By this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard was coming and is now already in the world. But a genuine teacher preaches Jesus Christ as the only Savior of the world, God in the flesh. And a genuine teacher guards the gospel and teaches it faithfully. In Galatians 1, 8 and 9, Paul said it like this. He said, even if we or an angel from heaven should preach a gospel other than the one we preach to you, let him be eternally condemned. As we've already said, so now I say again, if anybody is preaching to you a gospel other than what you accepted, let him be eternally condemned. Jesus Christ is the Word made flesh. He ransomed us, poured out his blood. He died, was buried, and resurrected. 1 Timothy 3:16 says, without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen by angels, preached among the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up in glory. And a true teacher will preach, there is salvation, nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. In a world that is calling on preachers to water down the gospel, to make God lower and man higher, to tickle the ears of those who come to church because they want large congregations and a large cash flow, there seems to be an ebbing of the sincere preacher and seems to be a highlighting of the insincere. What we are called by God to do as ministers of the gospel is to preach the truth, regardless of whether anybody likes it or not. And I can stand before God, and I stand before this congregation without an arrogance. Prayerfully, it doesn't come off that way. And I will tell you, I stand before God. To him I give an account. I'm not going to tickle your ears. I'll teach you the truth as the Word of God states it. That's what we've been called to do, and that's what a true shepherd shall do. We will lay our lives down for our flocks. We will tell you the truth, even if it hurts you, because that's the only way for you to be healed. And I'll do that until the day I close my eyes and I see Jesus Christ, and he says, well done, my faithful servant. That's what we're called to do. That's what we're called to do. I love my church. I'm going to be honest with you now. Again, sounds like I get real sensitive about that. I don't want to do. I'm just trying to be honest and open with you. I don't want to be lifting myself. Forgive me if it sounds this way, but I'll tell you this. People don't know this, and some of you will know it. Some of you do because you've been with us for a long time, but I'll tell you this. I loved my children, and I love my children, and I love my grandchildren with all of my heart. Anybody who knows me knows that's true. You know that's true. I love my babies, and I love my grandbabies. And I love the children that have married my children, like my own. I love them. But they know one thing, and they can tell you this. And it's the truth. They will tell you this. If you ask them, they will tell you this. If you want truth, ask my Father. He will tell you the truth. I don't sugarcoat it. Never have, never will. I loved my babies, and I will tell them the truth because I'm their daddy, and you need to hear truth from somebody. And I've always told them the truth. If they ask me, I will tell them. And there are times when I told them when they didn't ask me, because that's what somebody does when they love you. And I love my congregation very similarly to how I love my family. I love you guys. I will tell you the truth because God has called me to do that. I guarantee you that until I go to be with Jesus Christ. If you come to this particular church, there's one thing you'll know. That man up there fears God, and I don't fear you. I will tell you the truth because you need it so that it'll set you free. You need to know that. That's the bottom line. The bottom line. You know, I didn't go into the ministry to be popular. I went into the ministry because I believe it. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. I believe he died on the cross for me. I believe he poured out his blood to wash me of my sin. I believe that he was buried. And on the third day, he rose from the dead. I believe he ascended from the grave, that he went to heaven, and he's coming back for those of us who are awaiting him. And I will preach that. That's the gospel, and that's who we worship, Jesus Christ, God in the flesh, the Son of God, the Savior of the world. And that's what he says a true teacher is to do. And finally, the false teacher is going to be judged. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Therefore, by their fruits, you will know them. False teachers are thrown into the fire of judgment. Jesus said in John 15:6, anyone who parts from me is thrown away like a useless branch and withers. Such branches are gathered into a pile to be burned. They are judged severely because they deceive people, and the people were left lost, and therefore they are judged severely. Jesus said, whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and he were drowned in the depth of the sea. These false teachers are standing up saying that God has ordained homosexual marriage. We'll stand before God to give an account of that. But this man will teach you the truth. It's man and it's woman before God. That's what it is. And I won't perform any homosexual marriages. I don't care what the world says. And these guys, these whole denominations are yielding to that. But I'll tell you this, I have a lot of friends, Calvary Chapel pastors, and we've all said the same thing, to God be true. To God be true in these last days, as backwards as we look. And people will say, oh, you guys are intellectual hillbillies. You guys are just irrational, judgmental, you know, biblical rednecks. Well, you want to know something? I stand before the Lord ultimately, and I want to hear these words from him. Well done, my good and faithful servant. And that's what matters. And it has to be God's word. Somebody says, you hate people. No, I hate sin, and I hate what it does to people. It destroys them. It separates them from God, and they end up in judgment. But Jesus Christ came to destroy the destroyer. He came to give us life, and that more abundantly. I keep my eyes on him, but we need to teach the truth, because again, the truth is what sets you free. May we embrace the truth today.